नमस्कार, स्वागत है आपका राज्यसभा टीवी में। मैं हूं अमृता। उपराष्ट्रपति एम वेंकैया नायडू तमिलनाडु के दौरे पर हैं, जहां पर वो चेन्नई में डॉक्टर एमजीआर मेडिकल यूनिवर्सिटी के दीक्षांत समारोह में बतौर मुख्य अतिथि शामिल हुए हैं। इस वक्त वो छात्रों को संबोधित कर रहे हैं। आइए सीधा रुख करते हैं।
இன்றைய நிகழ்ச்சிக்கு வந்திருக்கும் அனைத்து தமிழ் உலகிற்கும் வணக்கம். தமிழம் தமிழ்நாடும் என் மனதிற்கு நெருக்கமானவை. நான் இந்த தமிழ்நாடு டாக்டர் எம்ஜிஆர் பல்கலைக்கழகத்தின் 30வது பட்டமளிப்பு விழாவில் பங்கு கொள்வதில் பெரும் மகிழ்ச்சி அடைகிறேன். இந்த நிகழ்ச்சியில் உங்களுடன் உரையாடுவதில் நான் மிகுந்த மகிழ்ச்சி அடைகிறேன். மை டியர் யங் ஃப்ரெண்ட்ஸ், த வுட் பி டாக்டர்ஸ், ஐ ஆம் ரியலி ஹாப்பி டு பி வித் ஆல் ஆஃப் யூ ஆன் திஸ் 30th கான்வொகேஷன் ஆஃப் த தமிழ்நாடு Dr. MGR Medical University. Name of the university is very great, named after great human being of the Tamil Nadu and India, Dr. M.G. Ramachandra. Name is great and also profession is great. Medical profession is the most noblest profession in the country and in the world that way. Convocation is an important day. In the lives of young graduates who have completed their courses and are stepping out into the world of professional careers. It is also an important day in the lives and careers of the faculty members who see this as a culmination of a year of professional growth. It is a memorable day for the parents of the children graduating today, because it is a fulfillment of their dream to see their children succeed. It is a milestone, the institution of itself, because each year the life of the university adds many alumni who will potentially raise the stature of that university with their performance. Dear sisters and brothers, I remember the day when I last came here. It was the swearing in of Amma Purachita Revi, Madam Jailer. It was a memorable occasion. Unfortunately, today she is not there with us, but her blessings are there for all of you. Tamil Nadu has been one of the leading states in the country in providing health care to its people. I am glad that Tamil Nadu Dr. MGR Medical University, one of the largest medical universities of the country, has continuously been striving to set and maintain high standards of medical education. It has been a pace setter in many ways and has successfully started new courses in medicine and allied health sciences according to the needs of the society and the emerging disease pattern. This university is also focusing on streamlining the skill training of the graduates in allied health sciences, which forms the backbone of the entire medical field. I am glad that the curriculum for allied health has been designed to incorporate the latest technology to make the student familiar with the operation of these latest equipments like dialysis machines, heart-lung machines and other modern technological equipment. I have been informed by the Vice Chancellor that this university is much sought after by students by SAARC countries for skilled training. I am told that the university is forging partnership with the developed countries like Australia to offer programs in public health. This is the need of the day. We need to learn from the best minds in the world. Now world has become small. We are living in a global village. What is happening here in this continent, subcontinent, is known throughout the world and what is happening there, what are the inventions, what are the new ideas, new courses, new technologies, new practices, best practices, they are known to us. That being the case, we must interact with the different universities of the world and try to acquire as much knowledge as possible. We cannot grow if we are insulated and isolated. Isolation is no consolation. We must really open up our minds. We cannot contribute to the world of knowledge if we are unaware of the state of the art in any of the disciplines anywhere in the world. As the great saint poet Tiruvalluvar has said, a quote, "In sandy soil, when deep you dwell, you reach the springs below. The more you learn, the freer streams of wisdom flow." This is what the great saint has said. The faculty should encourage the students to dwell deeper. This is possible only if the faculty members are themselves good listeners and good lifelong learners. I always feel that not only students, the teachers, the faculty members, even for that matter politicians, everybody should continue to learn. Instead of learn, better to learn. If you learn, then you can learn. So learning should be a continuous process, lifelong. I remember that I have been in legislature, in parliament, in public life for more than 40 years. But every day, every time, in every forum, on every occasion, I try to learn something so that I can improve my knowledge. So the learning is a continuous process. Please keep that in mind. Dear sisters and brothers and my young students, India has, according to the latest data, 479 medical colleges, out of which 227 are being run by the government, 252 are in private sector with annual admission capacity of 67,532 MBBS, 31,452 postgraduate students per year. Besides, there are 6,848 DNB seats which are equivalent to MD/MS. But I hope that this number should be doubled. You have a huge population and we have the prevalence of new diseases coming, and there is need for strengthening further the healthcare of India. I'm happy the Prime Minister has decided that at least one medical college will be opened in every district headquarters. That is the aim of the government. And states like Tamil Nadu, we must go for more and more medical colleges. You have the knowledge, and if you create infrastructure and provide opportunities, more and more children will get graduated in the medical courses. With the system is expanding and the government as well as private sector is focusing on increasing the number of medical colleges, the essential question that we need to ask ourselves is about the quality of medical education. I feel the time has come that we should open up. We have already opened up. We have to open up further to the private sector. Let there be competition between private sector and public sector. After all, who is private? They are our own people. But only thing is that you must have proper regulation. But I also would like to caution the authorities, regulation should not become a strangulation. The regulation is to benefit, to see, monitor, to have transparency and to have accountability in the medical institution is very much important. Namesake or institutions which are there on paper should not be encouraged at all. I am happy that the Tamil Nadu government, the day before yesterday in assembly, has approved two more private universities in the state. That is the need of the hour. See, ideologically opposing private institutions is no good. I must tell you, because after 70 years of independence, still there are gaps in our education, in our healthcare, in our other aspects. 20 to 22% of the people are living below poverty line. 22-23% of the people are illiterate. They can't read, they can't write. And there are a number of areas where you need medical facilities which are lacking. So that being the case, it should be public-private partnership. And we must encourage private people, well-meaning people, to enter into the educational field and also medical field. But at the same time, we must see to it that they all maintain standards, follow ethics, and also there has to be regular interaction between the government authorities and these institutions, and see to it whether they are following the procedure and maintaining the standards or not. That is also equally important. Medical professionals are different as compared to other professionals. They are looked upon as demigods by people because they make a difference between the life and the death of a patient, between their ill health and well-being. So people normally, after God, if they believe in God, look to doctor next. They treat them as gods. So my dear youngsters who are joining this profession, who are going to have practice, private or public government departments, please remember that this is a noble profession, and this profession should be treated as a mission and should not be for commission. There should not be any remission or omission of the responsibility. We should take it as a mission and then fulfill the ambition. Very important thing that has to be kept in mind. Service. Serving the poor is serving the God. This is what our elders say. Share and care are the core of Indian philosophy and our culture and our heritage. And you, doctors, you have an important responsibility towards the society of serving the needy, serving the poor, serving the suffering, reaching the unreached. And I am also of the opinion, because I know I am addressing medical university, I am of the opinion that we must also focus more and more on the rural area. Because while more than 60% of the people are still living, they don't have enough medical care. So that being the case, all the doctors, according to me, and I have already told the health minister, and I discussed with the prime minister also, we must make a regulation that every doctor, before getting first promotion, should serve in the rural areas for 3 years minimum. I am not saying there be there in the rural areas alone. Before first promotion, minimum 3 years, it should be mandated for all doctors to work in the rural areas. Otherwise, this rural area people feel neglected and they are denied the basic medical facilities. Please keep this in mind, and as I told you, the serving the poor, serving the need is serving the God. Manava Seva, Madhava Seva, there is a saying in Telugu. So keeping that in mind, we should focus on rural people. My young friends, society in India has had a reverential attitude towards doctors. And this respect is born out of the competence of the medical fraternity and the belief that doctors' advice comes from a pure objective concern for the well-being of the patient. Actors also are respected, but only momentary. But doctors are respected forever. Any patient will remember you for life if you cure his ill health. So keep that in mind, the nobility of this profession. This competence and the ability to render honest medical advice are at the heart of good ethical medical practice. Ethics has to be followed. Dear students, you have all put your best of your efforts to gain knowledge in the last few years you spent in this university. You have acquired the necessary knowledge and skills to make you a qualified doctor. Now you are all qualified. As you enter the exciting world of professional practice, you will undoubtedly have exciting opportunities to use the competence you have acquired. You will also have nervous moments of uncertainty as to what should be the diagnosis and treatment be. In those moments, be guided not only by what you have read and mastered during your course here, but also by the wise counsel of your seniors and the friends' suggestions from your peers. Under any circumstances, you must not swerve away from the path of dedicated, focused attention to the patient's welfare. Patient's welfare is the foremost, uppermost in your mind. Dear faculty members, I have an advice for you also. It is indeed a proud moment for all of you as your students graduate and blossom into sound medical professionals. Some of them got 4 medals, 5 medals, 3 medals. Coming from the rural background, ordinary background, I was inquiring about their parents also. Some of them, they come from normal background, still they are excellent because of the training you have given. The faculty also deserves compliments for the coaching and the training and the encouragement they have given to the students. I am sure you have not only imparted the essential knowledge, skills and attitudes required for their continued progress in their careers, but also have kindled the fire of curiosity and innovation within them that will make them seekers of knowledge throughout their lives. You must collectively build on the good work done by your predecessors. Even for the best, there is always possibility to become better. The quality of education in our medical colleges is the lifeblood of India's healthy future. We must ensure that it is green and provides the required vitality to the entire healthcare system in our country. I would urge you to consider the entire gamut of issues that impact the quality. There is a need for greater focus on teaching and testing critical skills and knowledge of new domains of medical science and fully using the power of technology and enhancing the students' communication and leadership skills. Sisters and brothers, India has been making a steady progress in improving the healthcare status of its population. For example, the life expectancy of a person born in India in 1960 was only 40 years, which has increased to about 70 years now. Of every 1,000 live children born in India in 1960, about 160 died in the first year. But you know, this death rate of infant is about 1/4 of that level. That's a great achievement. However, there are a number of challenges that have to be addressed. Nearly 12% of the deaths are due to heart diseases, lung diseases, and strokes are also major cause of deaths. Out of every 1,000 newborn children, 53 are not surviving beyond their 5th birthday. Stunting and malnutrition continue to be problematic. Those broad trend, however, do not reveal the full picture because they don't indicate the existing major inequalities between the states and between the people in various socio-economic strata. I am glad that the government of India and the state government of Tamil Nadu are focusing on these issues. Tamil Nadu is a pioneering state. Medical care in Tamil Nadu is known as one of the best health care. Nowadays, as India is on the move, people from abroad are coming to India. Earlier, politicians, particularly and patients, also used to go abroad for any checkup or any operation. But now, I'm happy to see, thanks to the effort by the Indian doctors, that patients from Africa, patients from Arabia, patients from Bangladesh, even patients from West, they are all coming to India. It is cheaper here now and safer here. Even in America, you might have seen in the recent magazines, I mean, American people are preferring Indian doctors there, NRIs. Why? Because of the knowledge, because of the skills, because of the attention, because of the service. So keep that in mind. We must try to excel in our life. Not being an ordinary doctor should not be satisfied. You must think of excelling. You must get a name in your lifetime. Dr. Kalam, Abdul Kalam, told the youngsters, dream high, aim high, and then work hard. Mere dreaming alone will be like a cinema ending after three hours. Dreaming, aiming, and then working hard. This is what is required. And this profession is 24/7. Anytime, anything may happen to anybody. You may be called to service. So you must have that passion. You must have that passion and compassion. Then only you will be able to really excel in your profession. In order to provide affordable, good quality health care for all, the Union Government is launching Ayushman Bharat. This is a national health protection scheme which will cover over 10 crore poor and vulnerable families. Approximately 50 crore people are going to be benefited. This is a major health care initiative taken by the Government of India. Providing coverage up to 5 lakh rupees per family per year, secondary and tertiary care hospitalization. This will help the people to access good quality health care and also greatly reduce the financial burden of the vulnerable sections of Indian population. This is also likely to spur the growth in medical infrastructure. While the whole world is moving towards more and more better medical equipment, including robotic surgery, the governments as well as the philanthropists are setting up medical colleges and hospitals. The system cannot function without doctors and paramedical staff. The healing touch can be only through human interface. It much depends on the doctor's attitude, the way you treat. I can share with you, sometime back, my wife, who never had any disease or any problem any time, she developed a menopause. We have met number of people and she was suffering like anything. Someone told me, sir, there is a doctor in Mumbai, Dr. Sonawala. You can contact him. Later, I found that he is 80 plus. Then finally, I took my wife and she met the doctor. He gave some advice. After I came back, then I asked my wife, how are you feeling? I said, she's told me, after meeting the doctor, half of her problem is already cured. The affection, the attention he has paid, the advice he has given, that makes all the difference. The receptivity, the affection, the concern you show to the patient, that is more important. Keep that in mind, that human touch will have greater healing capacity. Greater healing capacity rather than other districts and all. Now as you have now modern technology, machines and all, everything, now there is a complaint that people are saying for everything, everybody is writing X-ray, scan, MRI, this examination, without doing the original examination of the body of the person. You must first interact with the patient, understand what is his problem, basically, and then assure him of the needed care, and then go for other examinations, and then finally take, diagnose the problem, and then start treatment. That should be the attitude, because some people are saying, sir, going to that five-star heart hospital, then afterwards it will be, after seeing the bill, it will be like going to directly to heaven. That impression is no good. The hospital should remember that is a sector, service sector. I am not suggesting that every private hospital can afford free services. You can't get a robotic machine, you can't get MRI, you can't get a scan free. You have to, but at the same time, it has to be reasonable. Because I told you that this profession should be treated as a mission and should not be for commission, and there should not be any omission of the service. This applies not only to doctors, but also to the managements of the hospitals. This attitudinal change is very much important. Friends, youngsters, you all have unique opportunities to serve our people and transform India into a healthy nation. Health is more important than acquiring wealth. If you have health, you can acquire wealth. If you have wealth, there is no guarantee that you will be getting good health. Even if you have five-star facilities, you have so many cars, you have so much jewelry, so much money, and if you don't have health, you can't even eat. If you have diabetes, you can't eat even a sweet. Even so many things are available around you, you can't even touch that. So that's why people say health is wealth. Aarogyame Mahabhagyam. Please remember that the focus should be more on educating the people about the habits they have to follow and giving them proper counseling during the course of the treatment also. That is equally important. My young friends, I would like to caution not only you, through you, through this MGR Medical University, to the children, to the youngsters of the country, that they have to be careful about the lifestyle because of the sedentary lifestyle and the food habits. Morning, Dr. Badrinath, Sekar Netralaya, he met me along with another one doctor, and they were all telling me, and they have shown me a small film also because of the chunam, that powder, I think mixed with some tobacco, something or all. Chewing it will also cause cornea problems. It will affect that powder. So you have to educate the people. Cancer is becoming prevalent. Diabetic is fast spreading because basically of the lifestyle, the food which you are eating, the way in which you are living is becoming mechanical. Take it seriously that you have to come back to your original lifestyle, and there has to be minimum exercise of the body. Nowadays life is becoming so faster, and we are living in an age of LPG, liberalization, privatization, globalization. The life has acquired so speed, but at the same time, you must change your lifestyle, and everyone, I suggest, must love the nature and live with the nature. Nature, culture, for a better future. That is my advice to all the youngsters. Nature, culture, for a better future. This tree plantation, greenery, clean and green, then good fresh air, then bright sun, then good water. These are all very much required, and we have to live with them. We should love them and we should protect them. But we are playing with the nature, that's why nature is playing with you. Rains are not coming as per season because we have destroyed nature. We have cut down the forest. We have reduced the green cover. That's why now, again, the government and state and central government are going for massive tree plantation, going for Swachh Bharat campaign. Modi ji said, Swachh, green. Green, tanu, mana, dhana. Tanu means body should be clean. Mana means mind also should be clean, so that Nirbhaya type of incident do not happen. Dhana, even paisa, money also has to be clean. If you have clean money, you will have good sleep. If you don't have clean money, then you will not be able to sleep proper. Even if you get good pillow also, you will be always worried about the money that is kept below the pillow, if the money is not clean. So clean, green is very much necessary. Sometime back I was moving in London in a vehicle. The driver told me, sir, good morning. I said, good morning. He said, sir, very happy, today is a sunny day. I said, sunny day? What is sunny day? Is it your son's birthday? He said, no, sir, sunny day, bright sun. Then I told him, poor fellow, in India, 365 days are sunny days. But we are not harnessing sun. Now the government have taken initiative to go for solar alliance. Massive efforts are being made to take advantage of bright sun. And we must also expose ourselves to sun, because the life is becoming mechanical. The food we are eating is not suitable to us. Earlier, food used to be decided by our forefathers, grandfathers, their fathers, as per the season. Seasonal fruit, seasonal food, seasonal curries. We used to change the courses. Now everything is instant. Instant coffee, pizza, burger, all preserved junk food. By eating junk food, we are getting many of the diseases. we should understand. Our own food habits are very good. You have beautiful food everywhere, either in Tamil Nadu, in Andhra, or anywhere. Your idli, your sambar, your dosa, your vada, your pongal, your Nadu pongal, everything is very fine. If you are a non-vegetarian, your Chettinadu chicken, Chettinadu. If you are a Telugu fellow, your Nelluru chapala pulsu. Wonderful food is available for you. But now we are running after the foreign food, Western food, and then new varieties, new names are given because we have weakness for foreign names. And we have restaurants also, you go to restaurant, they will say, sir, chicken Manchuria, Manchuria, Bulgaria, Somalia, what is this? We should prefer our Indian food. We should not go for stored food. We should go for fresh food. This is my advice to the generation. Please understand this. This is very much required. And secondly, you must also do some exercise because there is no physical exercise at all. I am now 68 years, 68. Still I am active, going around. Yesterday I was here, day before yesterday I was in Pondicherry. One day before that I was in Andaman Nicobar. Today afternoon I have 3 programs in Vijayawada. Tomorrow morning I am leaving to Delhi and then have programs there. Why am I able to move around? Because every day I play 1 hour badminton. 1 hour. And also do some exercise. And then walk also. As and when, now walk has become less and talk has become more. We should reverse it. We should reverse it. Because lifestyle, as I told you, is becoming mechanical. You look at the lifestyle, you get up, morning. Earlier you have to go to toilet, little away. Now toilet is there at home. Okay, fine. Earlier you used to bend down to go for toilet. Now you have a commode. Earlier you want to wash your hands, you used to go out and then wash. There is no need now. Earlier to take bath, you have to bend and take water from the mug, from the bucket and then pour it on your head. Now you have shower. Earlier to eat food also, you used to sit on the mat. Now you are sitting on a table, dining table. Earlier you used to wash your hand, now you have finger about. Earlier to make a phone call, you have to go out. Now phone has come to your house. Earlier, initially you used to go to the corner to pick up the phone. Now phone has come to your ear and also to your mouth. Earlier to open the door, you have to go out. Now you have a calling bell. Everything, even change the TV also. Earlier you have to go out and then fine tune it. Now you have a remote. Everything has become remote. The result is physical activity has been reduced. And then because of the cinema, TV, and the Western culture, mind is becoming faster. And going through those contents of those programs also, you are getting tension in your mind. And there is no attention. If there is a tension, there is no attention towards anything. So keep this in mind. We must go back to our system, have a minimum exercise, then do yoga. Yoga is one of the beautiful art that has been given by India to the world. Thanks to Pradhan Mantri Narendra Modi ji, and he took initiative. 172 countries are practicing yoga now. 172 countries. We should all do some yoga, whatever yoga you want. I have been to Latin America 1 month back. I was moving in Peru, Lima city. And then I found to my surprise and pleasure, at 4 or 5 places there were yoga centers. In Peru, in Latin America, and we in India, which is the birthplace of the yoga, if you don't practice yoga, then how will you get Raja Yoga? We must do. And then Surya Namaskara. Some people say, sir, I have objection for Surya Namaskara. You don't want to offer Surya Namaskara, na? You offer Chandra Namaskara, I have no problem, whatever it is. Namaskara is our samskara. Some exercise is required. Food habits change is required. You must go for organic food. You must avoid junk food. And doctors should first give this advice to the patients. Whoever comes to you, please advise them properly about their food habits, about their lifestyle, and tell them the sedentary lifestyle is no good for them and no good for the country. Because India is on the move. If you are a healthy nation, you will become a wealthy nation. You can become a strong, stable, prosperous nation. So first of all, we must focus on this thing. For that, Swachh Bharat is required. That has to be made into a people's movement, and all of us should help people to maintain it. Friends, you all have a unique opportunity to serve our people and transform India into a healthy nation. You have been contributing to the same over the last three decades. You have a number of emerging opportunities in the present Indian context. You must be agile to adopt the best global practices for the benefit of our population. You must constantly set more ambitious goals and strive to achieve them. Let me leave with you an inspiring thought from saga sage Tiruvalluvar: when the rare chance comes, seize it to do the rare deed. When a rare chance comes, seize it to do the rare deed. This is what he has said. So please let us follow that advice of Tiruvalluvar and then become successful in our life, and then make life of the people also comfortable. This is my advice to the medical student. And as I told you, slowly India is becoming the health destination, health tourism hub. And I would like Tamil Nadu to be in the forefront of the health tourism, because we have knowledge. This land, this Tamil land, is very fertile. These brains are also very fertile. Land is fertile, brains are fertile. So that being the case, if we combine these and then work hard, we can really achieve the desired results of making a healthy state and then healthy nation. That's my advice to all the students and their mighty youngsters. All the best to all of you. God bless you. Nandri, Vanakkam.